We turn the lights up, please? All the house lights. You know, Veterans Day, to some people, it means a lot, but some people it means... I think we got it. Sometimes we lose the meaning in it. In life, we go through life and things, the meaning and the thought and the heart behind things kind of disappear. Some people just see it as a day off. Some people see it as the banks are closed. I went through the drive-thru, and Nicole was telling me she sat in the drive-thru for a while saying, "Where is everybody Friday?" "It's Veterans Day. No one's working." I did the same thing. But we got to remember, man, if we enjoy the things that we have in this country, if, you know, if we're so busy fighting about who believes what and what color of our skin, and we got all these things the enemy throws in and divides us, when the United States is still the best country, it's still the best format, it's still the best, we have the freedoms to come here in church. You know, a large or some percentage of the world doesn't even have this freedom. If we wanted to believe in Jesus Christ, we'd have to sneak into someone's house and look through the windows and are they coming to persecute us? Are they coming? You know, the same things the disciples went through and Jesus went through is still happening today in the world. There are people dying to follow Christ, right? So we got to remember the price that was paid for everything that we have today, that this freedom of speech, this freedom to protest that's going on right now, all these things, the right to bear arms, all these things we have come at a price. Come at a price. If you're lucky, the price was you were away from your wife and your kids and your grandkids and all this, and you had to spend time away not knowing if you was coming back. But the ultimate sacrifice is always there. Amen? So I want to take a second. If you, and just to recognize the people that have served in our country. If you've served in our country at any capacity, I would like to have you stand up real quick. Don't be shy. Amen. All right. Thank you, guys. Thank you, guys. And I'm going to tell you, my favorite veterans in the house, I love all of you, but I have a favorite, and that's my grandpa back there. I don't know if he can hear. Grandpa, can you hear? I'm talking to you, yeah. There was a little war he served in called World War II, so yeah. If you guys have time today before these gentlemen leave, and ladies, did we have any ladies? No, I don't think we had anything, but shake their hand and tell them thank you, okay? Because it's important, and it is. It's important that we recognize that. Tori, you going to come up real quick? I don't know what I'm talking about, and you'll correct me, and you might as well just do it. No? Yeah. Can you hear?
We're starting up life groups again. There's a sign-up sheet in the back. Basically, we'll meet the first. It's for 18 and older, married, single, whatever. But it's for, we'll meet once a month, do different things together just as adults. So sign up in the back. And there's a red piece of paper going around if you want the dating of it so that you can plan ahead if you have children that want
to do dating of it. Cool. Everybody got that? Life group, community is important. Let's get to know each other. Let's hang out. I'm pretty cool, so you want to hang out with me, okay?
Whatever.
You guys are brutal. A few announcements. Next week, the Fall Festival of Praise. Community, churches from the community come in here. We do a thing. This year's thing is the Heart of Worship. All the preachers will say a five-minute thing, and we'll get to see other praise and worship bands and stuff like that. It's really cool. What's going to be really embarrassing if we chose to host it and none of you guys show up, all right? You know, if First Baptist brings more people than we got here, come on, guys, we got to fill the house, all right? So I'm asking you next week, be here. Fall Festival of Praise starts at 6 o'clock. Is that right? Oh, if you want to be in the community choir, all the churches get together, sing two songs at the end. Be here today at 4 to practice, all right? Thanksgiving dinner's coming up. We got a big crowd back there signed up. Be sure to sign up for that. We are having a Christmas lights and ornament drive for the school, right? Is that just for Pate? For Pate. We need to start getting that stuff in. We are actually on the site council at Pate where we provide stuff for them. So please contribute to that. They need a bunch of stuff, lights and ornaments. And now I'm to a point here, I don't know how to say this because someone's going to, either someone here or someone who is listening is going to get offended, but that's not how I mean it. Cool? I'm just going to throw it out there. It's going to happen, right? In the name of Jesus, it's going to happen. This is not a political rant, all right? It is not a political rant at all. Today I'm preaching on I deserve to be counted out, but he gave me another chance. And it's not a political rant. I'm not saying that the former president did something that the new elect president's going to fix. But I am going to say this, all right? Whether you like it or not, God has opened a door for change. Amen? Amen? And it quite possibly, maybe, I'm not even going off on theorist stuff or the end of the world, might be the last chance this country gets. I am not saying the president-elect is the Messiah and he's going to save this place. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that President Obama is the one to doom this place or someone else could have fixed this place. All I'm saying is the door of opportunity to change has been open, and my question to you guys is, what are we going to do with it? Amen? Why do I know it's such a big time in history? Why do I know it's such a, that God's hand is in this? Because the enemy's hand's in it too. You watch the news? Why do they hate? Why is there so much hate? Why is there so much division? Why is it? Why that? And you can say all you want is so because some people didn't get their ways. To a point, that can be true. But all I know is there's a big spiritual stirring in this country, and it's got some people pointed in the right direction, and it's got some people pointed in the wrong direction to division. And the Bible clearly states that a house divided against itself will not stand, and we got a chance to become the church in a time like this and to bring unity, not in judgment, not in destruction, not in, and unity is one of these words. Does that mean do we compromise our values? Absolutely not, because our compromise of our values is what got us here, church. All right? But, like Brandon said to me earlier, the door of change has been open. Are we going to go on as business as usual? Because I'm telling you, in a few short years, it'll be business as usual for the enemy. All right? I heard a lot of people, I don't vote, I don't do this because it doesn't make a difference. Wrong answer. Wrong answer. Pray for our country. Exercise your rights. These veterans that stood up, present, past, and future, have died for you to have an opportunity to get out there and voice your opinion. Be led by the Spirit. Vote your heart. Vote your spirit. All right? And do what we can as the body of Christ to bring unity under the word of Christ, or God's word. Amen? Amen. So what are we going to do with it? So, I almost forgot tithes and offering. I would have been in trouble. So let's do tithes and offering real quick, and then we'll get into this. We're not too far behind. So, Father God, Lord, we just, again, thank you for this day. We thank you for this this opportunity, not only in this church, but in this country to advance the kingdom, Father. Lord, we ask that you just bring us together. Lord, we ask for godly values to be instilled in our children. We ask for hearts to be open, eyes to be open. Father, make it a supernatural event, Lord, that you just turn people towards you. I don't know the plan, Father. But I do see what's going on, and I do know that it breaks your heart. That's not what you came here for. Lord, I pray right now that that you just give us the strength and the courage, like I do every week, to be the people, to be the church. Lord, and as we pick up these tithes and offering, Lord, I ask you to bless them, to multiply them, and give us wisdom on what direction you want your tithes to go, Father. Lord, I love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said, amen. Amen. All right. Kids, you can get out of here. Please. Okay, so last 3 weeks, we started a series called I Deserve. I wasn't here last week. Ashley preached. She did a really good job. I thought it was a good message. Today, we're going to end that, this series, all right? But let's review a little bit. I Deserve. We started talking about that. We talked about what we think we deserve, both positive and negative aspects of what we think we deserve. You look around the country right now, what I just talked about, there's a lot of people standing up on a soapbox saying, I deserve, this is my right, this is that, right? We need to turn to God's Word to figure out exactly what we deserve. The first week we talked was what? I deserve death, but He gave me life. We talked about sin versus eternal life, right? That was the first foundation of these 4 weeks, what we actually deserve, because we all fall short of the glory of God. We have all sinned. We have all done things in our past. And what we truly deserve, according to God and His Word, is death, because the wages of sin is death. We find that in Romans, right? But thank God Jesus came to give us opportunity, give us a chance to choose, right? He didn't give us what we deserve. So the second week, I deserve condemnation, but He gave me mercy. We talked about the poor woman that was caught up in adultery, and like people do, religious people, any person, they look at someone else's situation. Was she wrong? Absolutely. Sure, she's caught red-handed. And they look at her situation and cast judgment. You deserve to be condemned. You deserve, you know, the law states that now we stone her. So it was humiliation. It was taking someone and just burying them in condemnation, right? But what did Christ do? Christ says, where's your condemners? Because Christ taught a message. He wrote in the dirt. He was showing everybody, hey, we're all guilty, right? Who are you to judge who is to be condemned and who is to be given mercy? And He began to show them their sins. They began to show them and to teach Him. And it said they walked away. So now there's a picture of just Jesus and this girl, and He looks up with her. Looks up to her. Everybody else spent their life looking, or time looking down on her for what she did. And He looks up to her. He says, where are your accusers? They're gone, my Lord. He goes, and I don't accuse you either. Right? Now go and sin no more. Third week we talked about I deserve rejection, but He offers me acceptance. Things we do to isolate ourselves, right? I was a master at this game, man. I would push everybody away by my actions, by my words, by my just not everybody just getting on my nerves, so get away. And then I'd wonder why, well, where's all my friends? Where's all my brothers? You know, come back to me, come back. Why? Now I'm mad at you because you won't hang out with me. Well, right? That's because I deserve through my hurts and my pains and my self-preservation, I deserve that rejection. And that's the same thing Zacchaeus did. He was a tax collector, robbed people, robbed the Jews, you know, stole money from him, made himself rich, and then caught in a place of isolation. And he saw Jesus, and he ran, and he climbed this tree, and Jesus looked at him, looked up to him again and said, come down here today, I got to be with you, I got to eat with you, and we'll hang out. He deserved rejection, but the love of Jesus gave him acceptance, all right? Looking back over the last 3 weeks, it's Thanksgiving. We should be truly thankful that God doesn't give us what we deserve. Amen? Amen? Are you a perfect person? Are you close? Do you have a little attitude sometimes? Do you push not only us away, but God away? Right? What we truly deserve and what we get is two different things. This week, we're going to look at ourselves again, like we do most weeks. I deserve to be counted out, but He gives me another chance, right? And I know these things kind of sound like, hey, Brent, you're kicking a dead horse here. We've heard it week after week after week. But this one's a little bit different. I have preached on it before, but this is talking about guilt and shame, okay? And not just any guilt and shame, right? Remember, this is I deserve. This is the guilt and shame that we kind of deserve. Does that mean? Does that get you listening? All right? This is the guilt and shame that has some truth behind it, right? Because here's what the enemy does. If he can't keep you in prison, he wants to keep you trapped in a prison mindset. Ashley talked about mindsets last week, right? You can be free all you want, but if you believe that you're truly still in prison, you'll never act like a free man or a free woman, right? You'll play these games in your head when you kind of test the waters of freedom and you're getting involved and things are going right and you'll test the waters. Then something will happen and you'll be like, oh yeah, I deserve that. And you'll recluse back and you'll draw back and, you know, someone will reach their hands in to help you out and you're like, yeah, I want free, but I deserve this. Guilt and shame's huge. See, there's a lot of us, I mean, if I took a percentage right here, some of you guys would be like, man, I have there's no guilt and there's no shame, right? There's nothing in my life that keeps holding me back. Man, you better quit fooling yourself sometimes, right? So, what good is freedom if you don't act like you're free? Amen? All right. Now, I asked this question a couple weeks ago. And remember, we're talking about guilt and shame. We're talking about that feeling, the aftermath, right? I asked you a couple weeks ago. I said, have you ever just messed it up? Have you ever blew it? Just big time. Messed life up beyond repair. We're talking about things like maybe having an affair a couple weeks ago I said get caught red-handed. What about letting your loved ones down, right? Guys, you're supposed to be a man, you're supposed to provide, you're supposed to protect, and then you are the one on the attack, who's going to protect them from you type things, and you realize that, huh? What about this one, being too scared to keep a commitment to the people you love? Amen? Right? I want to be there for you. I want to stick my neck out for you. I want to do the things. I want to protect the weak. But I'm weak myself, and I can't. Neglect your marriage, too hard on your kids, say things you don't mean, that's me. Fail to stand up for someone who really needs it. How about that one? You see someone going through something, it may be at work, it may be at school, it may be something, and you know that that is not right, they're being bullied, or they're being persecuted, and you just stay quiet. And that feeling you get from that when you walk off, I'm like, golly, I should have done something, right? Or that feeling when you dedicate your life to the Lord and you choose the same path that got you away from Him and you feel yourself pulling away and that shame you feel, that condemnation, that all that stuff. You know what I'm talking about? I do because I've done it, right? That feeling you get. It's like a blanket you put on, right? Where you're just sitting alone and you just I can't show my face. I just, you know what I'm talking about? It's not just a feeling. I mean, you feel it all over your body, right? I see it in church, man. See, you mess up and you can't come back to church because what are they going to say? Look at me. Oh, my gosh. I can't go back in there. I'm embarrassed because they know I did it. I know I did it. What about your kids, man? This is what I've done this with my kids. You know, like I said, this is a big one on me when I was younger, right? I fight for that control. Why? Because it's a fear. It's a pride thing. It's a fear. When I start losing control, when I can't fix it, I lash out. I got to get the toughest word in, the meanest word in. I've got to do the shock and awe of the household. I'm about to blow this place up, and I will say the meanest things. I would, you know. And this is before I knew God. I mean, I still got to watch it because it's still in there. But man, during my oldest son's life, before I knew God, there are some things that today, when I think back at what I said and what I did, I just put that coat of shame back on. I said, I can't believe that was me. Or the way I talk to people, right? This is me. Look where I'm standing today. I deserve to be counted out. I still deserve to be counted out. But you know what? God said, you got another chance. You got another chance. God says, I'm not done with you. You got another chance. I know what you deserve. But my love says, one more try. One more try. This country, God says, I know what you deserve. The choices and the votes that you put in there and all this, and I'm not even going to mention them. You know it. You've watched TV. You've seen Facebook. You know all the posts. The big dividing line between Republican and Democrat. You know all the choices. And God says, by your actions, by your attitude, by your you deserve to be counted out. But I'm going to give you that one more chance. Now, here's my warning. How many chances do you get? I don't know. That's not me. But all I do know is that that time will run out. And as long as you empower the enemy, as long as you empower shame and guilt and disillusion and pretends nothing's wrong, you are in danger because I don't know when it runs out. Amen? But I know what keeps you stuck in your rut. Right? It's a horrible feeling, guys. It is a horrible feeling. Knowing how bad that you messed up, how bad that you hurt them. Guilt, shame, embarrassment. You want to disappear, not show your face. One of those things where, you know, I've heard people say, I have messed up so bad that it will never be fixed. That's not faith. It's not a promise it's going to be fixed, right? Some people come into repentance and come to the Lord in hopes that he's going to fix that mistake they did. Now, sometimes there's consequences, and you go through those consequences. Sometimes you hurt some other person so bad that it's hard for them to say, okay, you get another chance, right? That's not what I'm saying. I'm talking about in the Lord, in your life. If you want it to count to something, if you want to stand up for something, if you want to create a legacy in the kingdom, not in yourself. Man, you don't want to build a legacy of yourself. I want to build a legacy of Jesus Christ and what he did in this area so people can look at this area and say, that's our example. What'd you guys do? We lifted Christ up. Amen? Wasn't the programs, it wasn't the praise and worship, it definitely was not a message because that dude was messed up and God gave him another chance and he gave us another chance and he gave our city another chance. But sometimes we can't get past this stuff that the enemy gets in us, these hooks, shame and guilt, right? It's times like this when you put on that blanket, I didn't even get a drink, I just opened it. And I'm saying put on this coat. Have you guys felt it? I mean, is it just me or can you just, it's just tangible all over you. You just feel like it's just, I don't know. I don't even know how to describe it. But you just walk around in it and it makes you miserable, right? It's times like this when you look at the drugs and the alcohol and the pain pills and the pornography or whatever your vice is, just trying to find some sort of meaning and enjoyment to kill the pain, right? It's times like this when you look at life and say, man, would I be better off just dead? Not alive? It's real, right? I have to kill the pain somehow, right? It's times like this where we search for excuses to justify and we look for excuses to blame, but deep down inside, we finally get to this point of realizing, man, this is me, right? This is me. It's not their fault. It's not because of this. This is me and my choices, and I don't know if I can go on, right? And in our minds, it disqualifies us, right? I deserve to be condemned, right? I can't show my face. I'm done. I don't even know if I did a good job painting a picture because it's hard for me to talk because, man, I feel it. Even talking about this, even going here today, it makes me put back, you know, it makes me just like grab those chains and all those feelings and emotions come back and I just feel like, you know, Sometimes, do you ever cry out? I mean, this sounds so sick and twisted, but it's the truth. Do you ever cry out, I deserve to be punishment? Just punish me, just hit me, just yell at me, just abuse me somehow so I can repent for this thing that I've done, so we can be back to square one? Someone just end it, right? We do that spiritually all the time, right? Sometimes it's easier just to go to Jesus and not just give him your sin, but just say, do something. You were beaten for me. I deserve that. I just want to be free. All right, we're going to talk about Peter today. I did this at Man Up last week. If you missed it, go back and listen to that stuff. There was a lot of good stuff at the Man Up conference. I talked about Peter at the Man Up conference, but not in the same context as I will today, but the same kind of story. I always tell you guys, next to Jesus, I really love Paul in the Bible, right? Paul's my John Wayne. But I tell you who I really associate life with, and that's Peter. Peter's kind of like me. He shoots his mouth off a lot. He always kind of fought for the things, maybe not in the right way, right? Says stuff all the time that Jesus just looks at him and is like, Peter, just shut up for a minute, all right? I associate with Peter. I can identify with Peter. He was a tough guy who got really broken. Really broken. Badly broken. To the point that when I read about him and what he's going through, it hurts, right? Sometimes when I read about Peter, I get that crazy allergies. I get where my eyes water. I don't cry. I'm a man. It's allergies. But my eyes well up because I know how he feels at that point. I know how it feels to look in the mirror and say, you blew it. You really, really blew it, okay? So, before we get started, I want you to know this. Jesus is here, and he wants to break the power of sin and guilt that is in your life. Amen? Even though we don't think we deserve it, even though we don't know we can get it, give it to him, even though we don't even know it exists, we just got all this stuff in our life and we don't know where it comes from, he wants to remove that so you can be free, so you can be productive, so you can feel like you belong, so you can feel like you are loved, so you can feel like you're part of the group, so you can feel like you're accepted, so you can feel what it feels like to have abundant life, not just desperate life. Amen? Today. Today, not tomorrow. Not a 12-step, not a you got to earn it. He wants to take it today. Do you believe that? No? Do you believe that? All right. So here we go. We're getting into Peter. This is where we're at in this time frame. They're already come back. Jesus has already come back. They're in Jerusalem, right? Satan has already entered Judas. Judas has already gone to the priest and sold Jesus out for the silver, right? They've already had the Last Supper. Everybody knows what's about to go down. And Jesus is starting to prepare them for the final days of his earthly ministry. He says, I'm going to die. It's going to be bad. And you guys are going to leave me, right? Imagine those words if you hear that, right? What if you came down to the altar and said, God, I give my life to you. I'm going to follow you. Things are going to be better. I'm not going to do this. And Jesus didn't give you the respond that a lot of churches said. He's like, nah, Jamie, you're going to leave me. As soon as it gets hard, Jamie, you're going to bolt, right? Not picking on you, Jamie, because he said that to me a bunch. I didn't realize that. He had to remind me when I did it. Told you, right? So let's start reading. Luke 22. We're going to go verses 31 through 32. I got to get there. Got to get there. It says, Simon, which is Peter, you know, is another other name. Satan has asked to sift each of you like wheat, but I have pleaded in prayer for you, Simon, that your faith should not fall. So when you have repented and turned to me, again, strengthen your brothers. Right? There's some key things in that verse right now. I have pleaded in prayer for you, Simon, that your faith should not fall. Did Jesus say, I have pleaded in prayer for you, Simon, that you don't fall? Did he say that? Why? Because Simon Peter had a choice whether he was going to fail or not fail. It wasn't up to Jesus. You got a choice today? To fail or not fail. It's not up to Jesus. Right? Jesus knew. He's already told him, you're going to fall away from me. He already knew the failure was coming. It was inevitable because of Peter's choices. Amen? He said, I pray for your faith not to fail. Hold on to that because that's going to be big at the end of the sermon. All right? What I want to talk about now is it says, Simon, Simon, Satan has asked each to sift each of you like wheat. And that's kind of what I talked about in the men's conference, right? Back then, they had these giant screens. They would put the wheat in there, and they would shake them and shake them and shake them and shake them. The bad stuff would fall through the screen, and the good stuff would remain in the screen. You know what I'm saying about saying? We're at work, we sift dirt. We jump it on a big screen that has big shakers on it. The dirt falls through. The rocks go away. We get rid of the rocks. Get rid of the bad stuff. But in order to do that, there has to be a shaking in your life. All right? Spiritually. God, don't do this to me. Don't, no hard times. Don't help save me from this. And he's like, no. It's part of the plan. You see, in the sifting, all this stuff that gets in the way that the enemy's planted in your head gets shaken off. No more excuses, no more blames, no more this, no more that, no more guilt, no more shame. It all falls off, and it leads you to a point where you're broken and fallen on your knees, and all you have is the truth, and you're just laying naked before him saying, this is who I am, and this is what you got. What can we do from here? Right? It strips you down to bare bones. It doesn't feel good. You can't hide anymore. Every mask, every intention, every good thing you were going to do, every excuse, it just all falls off. And you're left with you, and you're left with Jesus, and you're left with Satan. And you got to choose one. And you're left with the mindset, I've lost everything else, so this is me. Amen? Not a good place to be. But a necessary place to be, right? This is where Peter's at. You can't hide from the results. It's not a joyful time. It's a painful time most of the time, right? Listen, a lot of people, you heard this, it's make or break time. When you're sifted, it's not make or break time. It is break time. It is designed to break you so that he can remake you. There's no control in that. Right? For a guy like me, that scares me to death. Where's my choice? It's a kingdom, not a democracy. Where's my say? You don't have one. You're either a servant or you're not. Amen? These things you thought you were just got shook off. So, getting into our sermon today, there's a couple things. This is what we're after today. One, you already know, we're not going to talk about it. We all fail. I've already try to pound that home, right? Every week I say, you guys are a bunch of failures just like me. We all fail. We all mess up. You know that. Second thing we're going to talk about, second thing I want you to realize is there's things you do in your life that invite these failures, these open doors that we leave in our life, okay? And the third thing, hopefully, is what we need to get past these failures. Remember, Peter, I pray for your faith, but you are going to fail. That's Jesus' prayer. So let's get into it. Peter and Jesus continue their conversation. Luke 22, 33 and 34. It says, Peter said, Lord, this is where a lot of us are at. Lord, I'm ready to go to prison with you. I'll even die for you. But Jesus said, Peter, let me tell you something. Before the rooster crows tomorrow morning, you will deny me three times that you even know me, right? Jesus, the enemy's coming. He's going to sift you. You're going to fail. He's trying to prepare Peter. This message is trying to prepare you. You're not just going to fail little. You're going to fail hard. Maybe you've already done that. Maybe it's coming. Maybe you're in a dry place. Maybe you're in a redeemed place. I don't know where you're at, but I'll let you know that sometime in our life, the failure's coming. Because God loves you too much for you to stay complacent in where you're at, and the enemy hates you too much that he's not going to let you go without a fight. Amen? It's coming. And Peter says, Jesus, I'm all in. I'm all in. I'll go to prison. I'll die. And Jesus says, Peter, you're going to deny me not once, twice, and three times. And can you imagine, Peter? I mean, this is like us coming to the altar. He just got slapped in the face. Not literally, but spiritually. Sometimes I'd rather be smacked in the face physically than spiritually. Peter, you are going to deny me. Can you imagine this offense rising up? What if I asked this in church today or told someone that Marty came up to me and said, this is what I'm going to do and I'm going to do. And I was like, no, you're not. Right? You're going to fail, Marty. You're not going to do what you say you're going to do. Sometimes that would be easier if I could say that, but I wouldn't have many people in church, right? Because I played that game too. I'm going to do this. Well, this, and this got in the way, and I never did it. That's Jesus is calling him out in love. You're not going to do that, Peter. But that offense, man. See, Jesus opens this door to the sifting. Right here, Peter's starting to question. I mean, it doesn't say that, but in his heart and his mind, because I'm a guy, if someone I love and I said, I'm Steve, let's go, we're going to roll up on it, and I got your back, and we're going to do this, and Steve goes, no, you don't. I mean, like, maybe I shouldn't even like Steve in the first place. Maybe I should, you know, he don't believe in me like that. So Jesus opens this door for the sifting to begin. But see, he opens the door with truth. Right? He opens the door. See, we get offended when people start talking about the truth in our life. When the pastor, a good pastor, not me, a pastor starts putting truth in your life, you're like, that ain't for me. That truth ain't for me. I want to stay here covered up and put this coat on and just pretend that's not for me. I wish so-and-so was here to hear that because that's for them. Or my wife was going to hear that, that's for her. Or my kids, that was for them. And never once do we say, that's truth for me. But when Jesus is eye to eye with you and says, Peter, this is for you, right? Pretending doesn't set you free. The truth will set you free. The question is, I can't even do Jack Nicholson or I would. You can't handle the truth. I'm not even going to try. I want to so bad. It's hard for us to handle the truth. Why? Because the truth hurts, all those cliches. But real change doesn't happen until you peel back the layers and start to touch the truth. That's where the enemy succeeds. Right there. Right? By covering that up. Look at our country. Is anybody interested in the truth? Or are they interested in what they want? The truth in God's eyes, not our eyes. There's a big difference there, too. Let's keep reading. 22. We're going to skip down to 54 to 55. 22:54. All right. So it begins. Where are we at? Yep. It happens. Jesus gets arrested. 54. So they arrested him and led him to the high priest's home. And Peter followed at a distance. The guard lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat around it, and Peter joined them there. Who did he join there? The guards, not the disciples, right? Just so we're on the same page. The first mistake Peter makes, the first invite, this is what we're talking about, the things we do to invite failures in our life. The first invite for failure is the first door he leaves open to the enemy is he underestimates his own weakness. Amen? The first thing you can do to invite the enemy to work in your life through offense, through fear, through pride, is underestimate your own weakness. Peter hanging around with the disciples and standing there next to Jesus, right? Kind of like us in church. We all huddle around. We got it. Yeah, come on, rah, rah. Let's go get it. Right? He's like, I got this. I'll die for you. I'll go to prison with you. On my own, without you, I don't know. But I'll die with you. I'll die. I'll go to prison with you. Satan's not going to get me as long as I'm with you. Right? I will not fail. I got this. Nothing they can say, dude. He's pretty confident. 1 Corinthians 10:12 says, if you think you are standing strong, be careful not to fall. Peter is pretty confident in his strength. His strength's coming from being with his boys, the disciples, and being with Jesus, right? Jesus is a good one to be with when his strength's. Now, Christ will never forsake you or leave you. God will never forsake you and leave you. But sometimes there's seasons, and I've talked to somebody, where you feel alone and you don't hear answers. If Jesus is always right there, how are you going to let the enemy sift you? Amen? To grow you, to strengthen you. Sometimes you got to go through tests and trials, and you look around, and even though Jesus is right there, you don't see him because of everything else that is happening, and you feel alone. Where is your strength at now, Peter, when you are alone? Amen? You guys know I'm a sports guy. At least you should by now. And it's not just a sports. It's not like I love football. I love football. But it can be anything. Checkers. I don't understand chess. Not smart enough. Kind of a Neanderthal kind of guy. Not real brainy sometimes. But any game. I love the strategy of the game. Right? The strategy. I love watching the game plan. And when I coach, you know, I think I'm a decent coach, but that's what I like to do. If I was a really bad coach, I wouldn't do it. I know me. I know my team's strengths, but I also know my team's weaknesses. Amen? But you know what I want to know in my opponent? I want to know their strengths, but I also want to know their weaknesses. Why? So I know how to defend your strengths against my weakness and how to attack your weakness with my strength. Where are you going with that? It's not enough for you to be confident in your strengths. Some of you are tough. Some of you don't get hurt by words. Some of you don't get hurt when people push back. Some of you are tough on that, right? But sometimes there's some weaknesses in there that the enemy gets a hold of, and he picks, and he scratches. And now what used to be a little hole becomes a big hole in our heart, and we start to react because it starts to hurt, and we don't know where it's coming to. Now, the strength that we have start to being used by the enemy. Amen? Now the tough guy that is supposed to fight for these things of Christ are fighting against the wrong things in life because he's a tough guy and he knows he's supposed to fight. He just doesn't know what he's supposed to fight against. Amen? So, Peter knows his strength. Peter knows his strength with you, with you, with you, right? But look at what Peter does. When Christ is gone, the disciples leave. Who did we say he sat down with? The guards. The enemy. The ones that took the things he believed in. The world, if you will. Amen? Now Peter's mind is running. Now Peter's looking around trying to make sense out of all this. Now Peter's, you know, confidence is being, the sifting has begun. Right? Now, Peter's first mistake, underestimating his weakness, is compounded by his second mistake. I want you to see something, how this works. Your first mistake will lead you to another. Your first mistake will lead you to a choice, which will lead you to a habit, which will lead you to a lifestyle, which will lead you to a dark place sometimes, right? His first mistake compounds his second mistake, right? His second mistake was, well, we'll read a bit, let's read verse 54 again. Verse 54 says, so they arrested him, Jesus, led him to the high priest's home, and Peter what? Followed at a distance. Right? God, I'll never leave you, but something happened, and now Peter's not right beside Jesus, not going to jail with Jesus, not dying for Jesus, not dying with him. He is following him at a distance. You cannot follow Christ at a distance and not expect the enemy to come into your life and wreck your weaknesses. Amen? And this is what is happening. The enemy says, you left me a door. Once you didn't know where I could come in and you left that place unguarded, see, I'm going to attack your weakness here that you don't even know exists. You're kidding yourself. You're fooling yourself, Peter. So I'm going to slip in here, and now what I'm going to do is I'm going to trigger some events, some circumstances. Maybe it's bills, maybe it's spouse, maybe it's whatever. I'm going to trigger some circumstances in your life, and I'm going to put some distance in between you and Christ. Because you already admitted, Peter, that was your strength, so now I'm using your weakness to attack your strength. I'm pulling you away. Whew. And the enemy, see what the enemy did is he made him feel like he deserved to be pulled. You imagine the shame that goes along with that when you give your word and you can't do it? And now there's shame, and now you're following Christ at a distance, and the enemy is... Here's how the enemy works. The enemy will work with your feelings and emotions. Christ will work with your faith. Amen? So every circumstance that happens to you, why am I pulling out? Why do I need to drop this? Why do I need to get away from them? Why do I need to do this? Is it feeling emotions? Or is it God calling you through your faith to do something else? Amen? All right. So, I got some news for some of us here. Most of us here, we're not good on our own. Amen? You're weak when you follow out of distance. You're weak when you don't get involved. You're weak when you don't want to be close to Jesus, close to church. Maybe not this one. I'm not advocating or trying to advocate for engaged church, but you need to belong somewhere. Someone asked me a couple months ago, hey, what church do I need to belong to? And I said, hon, that's not my decision. That's God's decision. Yeah, I want you here, but you need to belong to somewhere where you feel like you're at home. Amen? Because when you're invested at home, you will fight for home. You will love your home. You will forgive others in your home in order to keep the unity of the home. It's your right to walk away. It's your right to follow at a distance and not truly get involved. That's all right to not be right there with God. It's all right for you to choose not to pray and to be in your word. And it's all right to push me away, God away, and all that away. But I'm telling you right now, when you do, you are vulnerable and you're weak. And when the sifting comes, you will fall away. And it will be heaped upon you. Amen. Let's keep reading Luke 22, 56 through 60. A servant girl noticed him in the firelight and began staring at him. Finally, she said, the man was one of the Jews' followers. And Peter denied it. Woman, he said, I don't even know him. After a while, someone else looked at him and said, you must be one of them. No, man, I'm not, Peter retorted. About an hour later, someone else insisted, this must be one of them because he is a Galilean too. But Peter said, man, I don't know what you're talking about. And immediately while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed. How many of you guys know at that moment when he heard that rooster crow, he took that jacket of shame and guilt and said, oh my Lord, what did I just do? I did everything Jesus said I was going to do because Jesus doesn't lie. This guy is the same guy who pulled a sword off and cut the temple guard's ear off when he was with Christ and when he was with the disciples. Now a servant girl asks him a question that shakes him to his core, right? Because I'll die with you, Jesus, but I don't know I'll die for you when I'm alone. Anybody hear that? I'll go to prison. In fact, what he said in Matthew's account of it, he said, if I'm lying, may a curse be on me. That's how confident Peter was in himself. And the curse was on him, right? Peter believed that he was strong enough. He fooled himself, right? Some of you guys, the only person you're fooling is yourself, because those closest to you and Jesus know. Jesus know, right? Luke 22, 60 and 62, it gets worse for Peter. But Peter said, "Man, I don't know what you're talking about." And immediately, while he's still there speaking, a rooster crowed. At that moment, the Lord turned and looked at Peter. Suddenly, the Lord's words flashed through Peter's mind. "Before the rooster crows tomorrow, you will deny me three times that you even know me." And Peter left the courtyard weeping bitterly. Man. Any of you guys hurt for Peter? Do you feel sympathy for Peter, or do you feel empathy? Do you know what it feels like because you've been there? I don't know him. I don't want to know. You guys got someone else. No, that's not me. And then the rooster crows, and just to make matters worse, he turns, and the Lord, already beaten, already bloody, already been through hell and back, is sitting there as a slave, a captive slave, a prisoner, and doesn't deserve it. You lock eye contact with him. Holy cow. Man, when I used to get on to my son, and I knew I overstepped the line, and I looked at him, and he looked at me, I was like, "Oh my gosh, what did I say? I can't take that back. I can't take that action back. I can't take those words back. I can't take back the fact that I wasn't the man I was supposed to be at the time I was supposed to be there. I cannot take that back. What do I do with that?" Amen. Peter wasn't crying. When was the last time you cried because of what you did? Not because you got caught. Just because you knew it was the wrong thing. Wrong thing. And you hurt the one you loved. You hurt the one you were supposed to protect. You turned from a Savior that gave it all on the cross, and you knew it was wrong. You weren't crying because you felt bad. You were crying because you were sorry. Sorry I was weak. Sorry I wasn't there. Sorry I wasn't the person you thought I was. Sorry I can't fix this. Sorry I let the enemy in to destroy our family. I am sorry. I'm sorry that I'm me. I deserve to be counted out. Peter, the rock had crumbled, man. He was broken. Carrie, you ready to come up? Remember when I said the sifting there is so, it's not a make or break, it is designed to break? Because in a broken state, in the sifted state, you just got, your heart's right there. Your heart's right there. The truth is right there. You finally realize who you are. You finally realize what you've done. You finally realize what you deserve. There's no more games. There's no more hiding. There's no more covering up. They'll forget about it, because they will never forget about it. And Jesus will never forget about it. And most importantly, Satan and the Father will never forget about it. Until you do something about it, it will always be there. And on the day of judgment, when you stand before him and you haven't repented for that thing that controls your life and makes you the way you are, he will bring it up and he says, "What about this? And what are you going to say?" "Well, I buried that." "No, because I dug it up a couple times to show you what was in your life that you needed to get rid of. And that thing affected that walk." John 21 through 3 through 5. God loves you. Jesus loves you too much to leave you there. You will not stay there in that broken state. Amen? You'll get up on your strength and carry on, or you'll get up in his strength and go forward. John 21, 3 through 5. It says, Simon Peter said, Jesus is dead. He's gone. He's in the grave. The body's missing. They don't know where he is. Some people are saying he's alive. He arose. He's conquered the grave. And other people are saying the Jews just stole him. We don't know where the body is. A lot of confusion, right? Adds to the fear. And Simon says, Peter says, I'm going fishing. We'll come too, they all said, the disciples. So they went into the boat and they caught nothing all night. This is significant because they went back to the same boat and the same lifestyle that they were in when Peter decided to leave everything and follow Jesus. Right? Back in the beginning, Peter, Jesus was teaching. Jesus gets in his boat. He says, let me preach in your boat. And they do. And as soon as they get done preaching, Jesus says, let's go out to the deep. Let's start fishing. And he was like, Jesus, we fished all night. We've cleaned the nets. We don't want to go fishing again. Jesus said, let's go. Go out there, throw your nets out. And they caught so many fish that the nets were breaking. You see, they were frustrated on their works and what they did and the lifestyle they had before them. But when Jesus gets in your boat and you obey and you push out in obedience, the reward is more than you could ever hope for or could handle. Amen? So this is significant. And because he was lost right now, full of guilt, full of shame, full of just licking his wounds, right? He went back to that life that Jesus took him out of into the boat. He says, I'm going to go back to what I know. Amen? And that's what he's doing. My heart for Peter, man. My heart for some of you guys, broken, don't know the answers, afraid, doing the best you can. Could you imagine? He's fishing. He's throwing the nets in, but he's just going, he's got to be just going through the motions. This is all I know. This is all I am. Work and toil. And feel sorry for myself. I deserve it. You know what I did? Your testimony becomes glorifying what the enemy can do in your life instead of what God has done in your life. This is all I do. This is why I'm created. And Jesus does what he did last time. Last time he preached from the boat, go deeper, cast your nets one more time. This time he shows up, right? 21:6. Let's start at 5. He called out. At dawn, Jesus was standing on the beach, but his disciples couldn't see who he was. He called out, fellas, have you caught any fish? No, they replied, right? Then he said, throw out your net on the right-hand side of the boat and you will get some. So they did, and they couldn't haul in the net because there were so many fish. Jesus does exactly what he does last time. He meets them in the middle of their life. He meets them. He says, I know you're broken. I know you failed. I know that you're just shame and guilt. He goes, but one more time, Peter, cast your net in obedience and throw it in. Right? One more time, Peter. Jesus isn't interested in leaving you broken, Peter. He says, one more time, no, I know you messed up. I already called that. I know you deserve to be counted out, but I don't always give you what I deserve. I love you, Peter. One more time. You know what? Peter could have said no and stayed in his boat, and that's what a lot of us do. It's hopeless. It's not going to be fixed, right? One more time, Peter, see what happens. In John 21:7, after they threw it in obedience, and they pulled it in, guess what? They didn't know who he was when he was standing on the shore talking. They didn't recognize the voice because they were following at a distance. They couldn't hear or see Jesus or make him out because of the guilt and shame in their own little boat, right? But as soon as they stepped in obedience and threw the net out, guess what? They knew who he was from the results. Right? Then the disciple loved Jesus, said to Peter, it is the Lord. And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his tunic, for he stripped for work, jumped in the water, and headed the shore. He didn't even wait on the rest of them. He didn't wait on the boat. He didn't wait for permission. He just came to the Lord because he knew the Lord was there to meet him because he was broken. Amen? So we covered two things. We all fail. We got that. the things we do to invite failure in our lives. We don't recognize our weaknesses, or we cover them up and we follow Jesus at a distance. Now it's time to get past our failures, right? How do we do that? Number three. Turn back to Luke 22, 32. I'm almost there. Jesus said it in the beginning, the first verse I read, 22:32, he says, "But I pleaded in prayer for you, Simon, that your faith shouldn't fail." That your faith shouldn't fail. You're going to fail, but your faith. You see, without that faith, not faith in yourself, not your faith in your own efforts, right? Because the sifting proved Peter's not going to do it in himself. The sifting proved that he wasn't going to catch the fish. The sifting proved that Peter was weak when he was alone. The sifting proved all that. But I pray that your faith doesn't fail. And after you repent, Peter, you'll turn to me, right? I pray that your faith in Jesus Christ doesn't fail you today. When you hear him, when you see him, that not only will you just step in obedience, but you'll run to him. That you'll dive in, you'll forsake everything else that you thought you needed. You'll forsake that old lifestyle, even if it's one more time. If you've already done it once, if you've already been saved once, that's okay. Did you fall away? Did you follow at a distance? Did you go back into the same boat that you were in before because that's all you know? Quit blaming yourself. Quit being covered up in guilt and just run to him. Swim to him. Jog to him. Fly to him. Whatever you can do, just get there. Amen? Jesus didn't care how bad the slip-up was. Jesus cared for Peter. He hasn't left you. He still loves you, and he wants to turn your guilt into grace. Just because you fail at something doesn't mean you're a failure. Failure is never a person. Failure is an event in your life. After Peter comes to Jesus, Jesus says, ask him more questions. See, the first time I have to believe that Peter was offended when Jesus said, you're going to turn away from him. He had to have something in him to say, what? But this time, Jesus does the same thing. Now, he's going to see if you've grown, Peter. He says, do you love me? And Peter's like, yeah. He goes, well, feed my sheep, right? Peter asks him again, do you love me? He goes, yes, Jesus, I love you. Feed my sheep. The third time. Three times, right? It's a process. He asked, do you love me, Peter? The same thing he says, and follow me, right? Peter had a choice. The first time he was offended and he pulled away. The second time he didn't allow offense in his life to keep him from the promises of Jesus Christ, right? He said, I'm going to stand my ground because I learned what it's like to go back to that lifestyle. I know it's not rewarding. I know it's condemning. I don't want to be stuck in this boat next year or the year after. I don't want to repeat the cycle. So something in me is going to have to change. And the only way it can do that is if I give it to Jesus Christ and be honest. I love you. Then follow me. You know what's so cool about this story? So cool that Jesus ascends, Peter's renewed, and on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit fell upon Peter, you know what he preached about? Repentance. Because he knew firsthand how to overcome guilt and shame and to come to Christ for repentance. You see, the method, the process leads to a renewing, not of just your body, but of your mind and of your heart and of your soul. And if you try to skip the process or cover up the process or lie about the process, you won't come to a place where God can use you with the testimony. He doesn't want pretenders in his army. He wants truth, because the truth will set people free. I don't know who that's for or if it was just for me, but there it is. Now what you gonna do with that? Amen? Amen? Inevitably, some of you are gonna be like, I'll put it in my back pocket. Some of you are gonna take it home and you're gonna chew on it a while and digest it, and you're gonna be like, oh my goodness, my eyes are open. Some of you might just like Peter was, jump in the water and swim down and meet Jesus himself. But it's yours. It's yours. And if for nothing else, he did it because he loves you. So if you love him, let him claim the prize he died for today. Amen. Let's pray. Father, Lord, I just thank you for that opportunity to share your word today. And Holy Spirit, I know that that word's going to hit its mark today. Father, I'm so tired of our hearts and minds lying to ourselves, pretending to cover up and just, Lord, I pray right now for the truth in our hearts to bubble to the surface, Lord. Lord, those hidden things, those pains, those insecurities, those things that we've tried to cover up, Lord, I pray that they're brought to the surface today and dealt with in Jesus' name. Because there's a whole world out there that needs to hear your message. There's a whole world out there that needs the power and life of the testimony. But Lord, you're not going to use anything but the truth and anything but the love. Father, let them feel safe today to come to you. Let them feel your love today. And Lord, I rebuke every lie the enemy has told them that keeps them in that cycle. Lord, freedom is real, and freedom is here, and freedom has the name of Jesus Christ. And my heart pours out that we get that, Lord. Father, we seek you today. We glorify you today. And we need you today. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Have a great week.